The old man's cabin had been very generous to Mara. He couldn't have asked for more. It was a typical shack, just like the ones you hear about in Quebecois legends. Local lumberjacks used it to rest and twice a day heat up their pea soup. Leftover food, the clothes, the general warmth of the place, no evidence of escape. Carl was sure of it. People were here not long ago, and they expected to come back. Someone had been playing with a crossbow here. A very dangerous game. A bolt could hit someone's tire or their eye. It could even kill someone if the aim was right. Without a single window to brighten things up, the inside of the cabin was almost pitch black. Beware of close encounters of knee and furniture. Everything was set up for a well-deserved snack. It seemed like the place hadn't been empty for long, but without knowing exactly why, Carl had the feeling no one was coming back anytime soon. Solitaire, a card game only hermits can truly enjoy. Carl felt depressed at the thought of playing this. A wintry atmosphere surrounded the house. The soundlessness of the area suggested it was empty. Carl's big fingers prevented him from reaching the key. When finding a boot, one wonders what became of the foot. The key, which seemed to be meant for a padlock, bore an inscription reading Cruce Efis. A company name. Better keep an eye open. Businesses weren't exactly numerous around these parts. Money in a jar. What a shame. Carl would have loved cookies. Thank you. The Spirograph amused Carl. It was a nice modern toy. Aside from being repetitive by nature and completely useless, still, it found its way into many Quebecois homes. Little Martin Blais with his uncle Pierre. There was a deep sense of bonding and pride coming out of the picture. Carl felt sorry for the man. No one deserved such a cruel fate. The picture had been taken inside the house. It was the same wallpaper. Judging by the smiles, nobody suspected the impending misfortunes. Hay stub for some undoubtedly harsh lumberjack work. Alexandre Blais felled trees and chopped woods for Cloutier et Fils. A window left open in that weather? Perhaps something had to be watched. Fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? The crossbow bolts had the same origin. Carl was sure of it. Who was it? And more importantly, what was being hunted like this? There was only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another road. Mm-hmm. Carl knew why he was suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. Carl sensed that the cold was beating a retreat, as if he was moving away from some kind of center of gravity. Welcome to Alibaba's Cave, Lumberjack Edition. Surely Carl would find something worth his time in here. Thank you. solitaire, a card game only hermits can truly enjoy. Carl felt depressed at the thought of playing this. Steak alone cannot subdue a starving stomach. An appetite comes with eating. Carl was becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. What could it be? A key. What could it be for? The garden shed? Carl couldn't reach it with his arm alone, but he had more than a few tricks up his sleeve to pick it up. The further Carl moved away from the ice block, the more his senses came back to him.
Thank you.
The air was freezing right down to the bone. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. Looks like the holes in that puzzle are there to stay. Was cold, and the stew inside wasn't cooked. It's likely that poor Giselle was slow cooking it before she got snapped. What a waste. Ah, moving. What a pleasant activity. Of course, you'll find the record player only to find the records weeks later in some random box. The general store, along with several more infrastructures in the area, had been acquired by wealthy industrialist William J. Hamilton. Perhaps the village should be rechristened Hamiltown. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChausses had just moved in. What a mess! Clearly, there was some major revamping work underway here. The place looked barely habitable. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChausses had just moved in. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Beautiful portrait of Jill and Giselle. Bound together by the chains of conventional love. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChausses had just moved in. In his back. Another vision took over him. Something was hidden under the stairs. The man grabbed his rifle. Carl felt a sense of dread in him. Perhaps their spousal relationship had been cooling down lately. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. Vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which Giselle, Jill's loving spouse, was motionless, frozen in ice. Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double-layered security system blending letters and numbers. Its code couldn't be broken by the common burglar. Looks like the holes in that puzzle are there to stay. A shiver ran down Carl's spine as he glanced over another body trapped in ice. Indeed, the scene was quite chilling. Carl felt familiar shivers going down his spine, and he was back to the realm of vision. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. These engraved numbers mean. A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. Vision slowly faded away, like an icicle melting in the palm of your hand. Carl, back in the real world, now knew who the icebound man was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. That had to be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts. Or not.